We have our final speaker before we take a coffee break. I will not say what the coffee is made of, but anyway. Bernard Giroux, president of Livelihood Venture. Please bring an applause for him as well. So the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Thank you for inviting me to come here and speak. I will talk about the Livelihoods Fund. I run this fund. In fact, it's two funds. One is the Livelihoods Carbon Fund, and the second is the Livelihoods Fund for Family Farming. So right in the topic of today. Actually, I'm from the private sector. I was vice president of Danone for sustainability. And a few years ago, I decided to co-fund with colleagues the funds I will present to you today. In fact, it's not that much about should we invest and what is the difficulty to invest from a private sector perspective in smallholder farmers, but it's also about how the way we invest can have a negative or positive impact on development, on SDGs. So if we look at the situation as it is today, we cannot be very proud of ourselves, whether we are from the private sector, from government, from NGOs. Because if we look at the whole picture, it's about inefficiencies. Inefficiencies, and we had a lot of examples with the previous presentations. If we take the farmer's side, it's about low yield. I will show you an example with cows in Kenya producing 3 liters per day. And it's what we can see in many parts of the world. It's farming practices that probably, well, sometimes have a huge negative impact on deforestation or soil degradation. It's about lack of access to market and so on. From a company point of view, it's not that efficient as well. It's volatility. It's about volatility in volumes. I'm not talking only about prices. It's about traceability, poor traceability, quality, supply. And of course, we have all the stakes related to environment, to water resources, to carbon, to soil fertility, and so on. So at the end of the day, if we look at the picture, and in front of that, we put the challenges we have to feed 9 billion people in the coming years. We absolutely need to increase the efficiency of those models. If we are now we take the shoes of the private sector of a company, whether it is a large multinational or a smaller company, in fact, we can see a very deep change. 10 years ago, there was little debate within the private sector regarding the supply. It was mainly about quality, price, and securing volumes. Now, and since I would say mid of the year 2000, we have seen a huge debate. And now, not only the company I worked with, but in large multinational and smaller companies, not only from developed countries, but also in developing countries, there is a debate. There is a debate that means that companies realize that they have to deeply transform their supply chain. And it's for business reasons. It's not because they are now a good company, they were bad companies before. No, they realize that their future is at stake because consumers are asking for that and because they need to secure the quality. They will no longer have a good supply if they do not take into account the whole supply chain. And over the past 50 years, the private sector has disconnected the supply chain. We didn't want to know where it comes from. It was about price, it was about volumes, it was a lot of intermediaries. And now with traceability, more and more companies have to prove and they know where it comes from and they know the impact of their supply on the social livelihoods of people, but also on the environment. So it's an opportunity. Low efficiency and this new understanding brings new opportunities for investment from the private sector in agriculture. The complexity for investing when we look at what are the investment in farming today, for example, in Africa. In fact, you have private investment, but private investment where private investment is quite comfortable and secure. So where you are the private sector, you invest in large farms or you invest in processing facilities. It's much more difficult for the private sector to invest in a group of 10,000 smallholders, for example. So the complexity of project and the fact that farmers are many in an area is a main obstacle for the private sector. And even if you look at public funding, it goes usually through governments, but not directly to smallholders. Or it goes through grants, but very not so often through investment. So we need for that to create kind of coalition, and I will show you an example. There is also a second obstacle, which is a time lag. When you invest in agriculture, the return is low. In our funds, we invest on 20 years or 10 years, depending on the type of project. But the classical private investment doesn't like this type of long-term investment. So we need to create special vehicle. If you keep this investment in agriculture in the private normal boundaries, it will not happen. There is also a tendency in the private sector to go what I would call narrow. If you want to source cocoa, you look at cocoa. You look at the efficiency of what you source. And I think many public institutions go this way. As it was said before, the Ministry of Agriculture will look at some aspects. The Ministry of Environment will look at other aspects. And the private sector is the same. So how can we switch from this very silo approach to something that is more holistic? And of course, even when I have discussion with public institutions working with the private sector, their expectation on financial return is much too high compared to what such a project can deliver. I was told for a very famous international institution that they were expecting 15 to 20% financial return on our investment. I said, well, you know, if we can make 4 to 5%, it's already an achievement in a world where the majority of the money that goes to farming is grants and not investment. So the purpose of what I will show you now is about reconnecting the supply chain. And we try to do it through three levers. The first is investment. We believe in investment. We are not against grants, but we believe that investment puts a duty, an obligation. For example, in Senegal, 5 years ago, we have started to restore the mangrove of Senegal. A huge project, 10,000 hectares of mangrove have been restored with 300 villages. It's the largest project of mangrove restoration. It brings a lot of fish, of oysters, a lot of food for the people and also income. But it's an investment in a sense that we have to bring back to our investors all the carbon credit that will be sequestrated in this mangrove. And I can tell you that the way we design the project, because we have to give the money back to our investors, puts an obligation on ourselves. It's not because we are better than others, but it's not the same traditional way. We ask for a grant, and when the grant is spent, we ask for another grant. We need to get back to our investors. The second one is cooperative. We strongly believe that no institution today has the power to find the solution alone. The private sector is not able. I'm not sure the governments alone can, and the NGOs can bring a lot, but alone, they probably are not able to solve such an issue. So the question is, how can we create coalition of actors between public, private, and civil society, but concrete coalition? but what I sometimes I call some coalition blah blah coalition. I'm talking about coalition that deliver results in the field. I will show you an example. And then impactful solution, meaning that we are not talking about extraordinary things. There is a lot of knowledge of technology. And the issue is to choose the one that are accessible to the smallholders. Low cost, easy to implement, easy to scale up. The question is how we can make those technologies accessible to a huge number of farmers. For us, there are three principles that we are trying to implement. First is farmers are the key actors. There is no project if the farmers are not the heroes of the story. It's not about top institution, whatever, no. Is the model that we are implementing attractive for farmers? Do they get some direct benefit from it? Do they realize the benefit for them? And then they become actors and the project has some chance to succeed. Affordable and replicable practice, that's what I said before. It's not necessarily irrigation, which is very capital intensive thing, but how can we use better rainwater with 30,000 farmers, as we will see in Kenya? It's low cost. We can plant trees. Agroforestry is a very cheap technology. Training farmers is not that expensive. How can we select the combination of best practices? And then at landscape scale, and this is not the normal, the classical shortcut for the private sector. If we look at a certain commodity, we will look at this commodity. Landscape is, okay, I look at palm oil, but around palm oil, people are deforesting. How can I take the whole area, incorporating the deforestation area, and how can we increase the productivity on palm oil? Okay. Then I will take an example. In Kenya, it's a project that we are starting right now with a Swedish organization. Probably many of you may know this organization called VI Agroforestry. In fact, we start from a very simple thing. There is 30,000 farmers in the Mount Elgon area near Uganda. They have less than 1 hectare per farm, very low income and livelihoods at stake. On the other hand, there is a Kenyan company, Brookside, a dairy leader. They need more milk for the Kenyan market. And then there is a huge issue related to Lake Victoria, and the Kisumu Water Utility needs more water, and this mountain is a main water shed for this Lake Victoria and the cities around. So, what can we do? We can, in fact, make a combination. So we are ready in this project to invest several million euro in this project from the private sector. This investment will go through an NGO, through VI Agroforestry. This NGO has demonstrated that they were able to implement such a model, low-cost model, very efficient model, at large scale, already in another area. If we implement the different practices that you can see here about farm management, soil management, milk collection, we will have an impact on farmers' revenue and cash crops, but also food crops. We will have an impact on water. We will have an impact on climate. 1 million tons of carbon will be sequestered, and the milk company will be able to collect a significant amount of milk. Today, they have a big collecting center, and this collecting center doesn't collect that much. Why? Because the productivity per cow is very low, 3 liters per cow, as I said before. So if we look now at the investment model itself, the local company, the dairy company, will pay a fee. They will buy the milk from the farmers at market price, a bit above the market price. They will pay a fee to the fund, because they will get the milk thanks to the investment, to the farmers' improvement. The carbon market will pay for a part of it, and the local government will pay for the water services that are generated by the project. So if you take the whole model, we will invest several million. This money will come back to the fund. Each stakeholder will pay a lower cost, but we are all linked through a contractual agreement between governments, the private dairy company, the local NGO, and the farmers, and our fund. Okay? So I will, just to summarize, the model that we propose is first to invest upfront. There is no progress if we do not take the risk to invest upfront and not buy externalities. It's to maximize value creation for farmers and monetize externalities, which is, for a government, could a government pay for the externalities that are produced? It can be gender empowerment, it could be a deforestation issue or whatever. Okay? This fund will invest 120 million in the coming years with the objective to impact 200,000 farms and 2 million people. For the moment, 4 companies have joined this fund that was created a few months ago, but we are capitalizing on the success of the first fund, which was invested by 10 corporations, and have already invested 40 million euro in similar models. Thank you very much.
Thank you.